Welcome to the You Shall Not Pass version of Shiloh on Major General Difficulty in the JMP mod. Just to be clear, this is not the same army that I just took to Shiloh using the mobile forces strategy. This army is from the campaign I completed before I started recording this series. In a conversation with Something Compass, we discussed different strategies for Shiloh, and I mentioned that holding your position can still be done on Major General Difficulty, but it can be hard to pull off without getting supply wagons in the first two phases, and you tend to take a lot of casualties on the left flank. Since I try to remember to save a pre- and post-battle throughout my campaigns, I pulled out my previous army from retirement and built a version specifically to win Shiloh on day one, and this is a demonstration of that. Just kind of a bonus Shiloh onto this series. Doing some compare and contrast between these two armies that I have, I've concluded that disbanding the army just once after Philippi and putting points into AO to build 14 total units before distress call results in a better outcome than only taking 10 units to distress call and disbanding again before building the 14 units. The army that I'm using here has 13 two-star units. It's heavier on infantry, and I did not have to swap out any officers to get them to their second star. The army that I've built for this YouTube series has 12 two-star units, but I had to swap out two officers just before Shiloh to get them their second star, and that army's also heavier on skirmishers. With the 12 two-star army in the series, I got 1 point into training earlier and took as many soldiers as I could into the stress call, but in fewer, bigger units. With the 13 two-star army I'm just using for this battle, I put both of my career points after Philippi into AO to give me 3 divisions and built all 14 units that I'd be using working up to Shiloh. I have to conclude that getting the battles led bonuses earlier resulted in a better overall outcome than getting an earlier point into training and disbanding twice. With the battle leds bonus, newly created units start with a minus 7.5% penalty to experience and to command, as you can see in the officer experience bar. With one battle led, the penalty goes away. With two battles led, the officer and unit get a 7.5% bonus to command and experience. With 3 battles led, the bonus increases to 15%. And with 4 battles led, the bonus tops out at 22%. If an officer is wounded, he will keep his battle-led bonus if brought back to the exact same unit after he is healed, but the counter starts over if he's put in charge of a different unit. Depending on how long the officer has been wounded, you may find that your replacement surpasses your original officer after a few battles. Keep in mind that all the one-star units I've assembled in this camp were solely selected to get a day one victory at Shiloh. Long-term performance was not a consideration. For example, I gave most of my new skirmishers a late infantry perk, and I have several infantry brigades using muskets with melee perks for just the counter charge ability. I'm also using fewer and larger units than I did with the mobile forces strategy because I need these guys to be able to take some losses and still remain effective. 1st Division will deploy to the Union right, and the game always does that. If you have brigades that you absolutely want on your right flank to start the battle, then always put them in 1st Division. In the original campaign with this army, one of my artillery commanders was killed at 1st Bull Run, so I put Colonel Brooks in there to get him up to general, and then at Shiloh's camp I moved him to a division commander, but for this battle I'm going to leave him there as the artillery unit commander, so they'll keep their second perk without having me to hire a high-level officer again. In 2nd Division, 3 units will deploy to the right flank and 3 to the left flank, but you may not be able to predict which ones go where. In the mobile forces battle, the AI sent the last 3 brigades to the right flank, but in this battle, they will send the first 3 brigades to the right flank. So I've put all infantry into the 2nd Division, so it doesn't really matter which 3 go to which side. Deployment is fairly consistent with 3rd Division. The first 2 brigades will go to the Union left at the start of Phase 2. The other brigades will deploy at the Hornet's Nest. I want one of my 2-star units to be oversized to anchor a key position on the Union left near Larkin Bell Field, so I've gave Woods to all of my rebores, and he will end up with the most kills when this battle is over, or a little over 3,000. Both my corps commanders have accuracy perks. 1st Division and 2nd Corps deploy consistently, with the first five brigades coming in as the reinforcements to the right flank. The last brigade in that division will deploy at the start of the left flank. And 2nd Division, Loomis, Chu, Marston, and Drayton will deploy at the start of the second phase, which is the Union left. Reinforcements to the left will be Morgan, McHenry from 2nd Division, along with Einart, Pugh, and Mason from 3rd Division. Whereas in my mobile forces version of this battle, most of my infantry and all of my guns deployed at the Hornet's Nest. In this battle, I'll only have 6 units come in at the Hornet's Nest. There'll be 3 skirmishers and 3 light guns. Everyone else will already be on the field. We'll get both of our supply wagons at the Hornet's Nest. In about 30 minutes into the Hornet's Nest phase, we will get Amon, Bruce, and Hazen's brigades from Bell's Advanced Forces. Like my previous battle, I have 10 in training, 6 in AO, and 1 in recon. I have more officers available because I didn't build as many units here. The armory is pretty bare now. I also took both Irwin McDowell and William Sherman with my reputation points. The deploy screen indicates an even fight, but once we subtract the 22,000 soldiers from Buell's day 2 arrival, it's closer to a 2-to-1 advantage for the Confederacy. Defending the area around Shiloh Church isn't too bad. I tend to deploy skirmishers to the left of the screen, and my infantry to the right and to the center. I also place all of my artillery in the center right behind the VP so I can cover as much area as possible. anything you can do to engage a little early with skirmishers can slow down the AI a bit. If you just sit back and wait on the north side of the river for the AI, he will eventually steamroll you. My skirmishers have both picket and zalvoy perks, so they won't take very much damage, and every minute they delay the Confederates, the closer my reinforcements are to arriving. Hardin's infantry brigade here is near the water just to support in case the AI tries to catch my skirmishers when they need to cross back across the river. I almost forgot. In my current campaign, I've not had one ghost cav appearance yet, but I do get one here in this battle in the opening phase. It's one of Lindsay's melee cav. I will call it out when it happens. Early in my campaign, I said that I don't allow ghost cav to hang around and that I always handle them in the exact same way, no matter when or where it appears, which is I'll immediately do a save and a reload to get the game to reset the sprites in the correct on-screen location, and that's what I do here.
Thank you.
I prefer to use cav and skirmishers as reinforcements here on my right side because they can move forward quickly to wherever they're needed. If the battle's under control, then the cav can sweep around to the left of the Confederates to go steal a supply wagon. Not having supply wagons at either the left or right flank is really one of the big challenges early on, so I tried to steal a wagon in both phases because I want my artillery to be able to fire as much as they can. Bliss has two melee perks, so he can be downright deadly as long as his condition stays good. Thank you. Lindsay's 2nd Brigade is Ghost Cav. You'll see his actual location in a second. The sprite showed it to be just southeast of the VP, but he's actually northwest of the VP. I'm damn lucky he didn't take out my artillery before I reset his location. Stevens' 2 3-star brigades are the only ones that make me worry at all. If they rolled both mailing and speed perks, they can raise a lot of hell. Everyone else seems to be fairly manageable. Every volley that a unit takes degrades its morale. So although smaller units may not be killing a lot of men, they're chipping away at the morale to make them rout. That can be seen here in on the mobile forces battle. There is a supply wagon ripe for stealing on the Confederate left. There's another wagon farther to the south. Then we'll try to take out some artillery stragglers.
Thank you.
One of Steven's 3-star units is going to end up parked in my backyard before this phase is over. Fortunately, Steven's other 3-star units is trying to recapture the artillery we took earlier. The plan is to start rolling up the Confederates' flank on this side and pushing them back toward our left flank, while our left flank forces hold on and stand their ground at Spain and Larkinbell Fields until help can arrive from this side. Here is the strategy I'll be using on the Union left. One thing that is really important to understand about this portion of the map is exactly how steep of an incline there is going up to Larkinville Field. The grading's not so bad at Spain Field on the left, but everything to the east of Spain Field is a pretty steep grade. The key to holding this flank is to create a funnel effect towards Larkinville and cause a massive traffic jam near the river south of Larkinville, so they have to climb the steepest bank to get to your forces. Bragg's forces are coming in from the lower left of the screen and moving in a diagonal direction towards Larkinville Field. It will take him a bit to get over that far, and his troops come in two waves. The first wave, which usually includes Gibson and Gladden's brigades, tends to be the furthest to the left of the screen, and they usually take a run at capturing Spain Field. I'm absolutely shocked that they don't try to do it early on in this battle. That is usually the earliest part of the fight, and if you hold them off, the AI tends to lose interest in Spain Field and starts to concentrate on Lark and Bell. In this battle, they seem to ignore Spain Field, so I end up moving my forces forward. The cover in the area can be deceiving. Just because you see trees doesn't mean it's the highest coverage area. So be sure to check the coverage rating while positioning your forces. General Breckinridge will be the last of the Confederate forces to come in, and they enter the battlefield all the way to the south of Lark and Bell, which means they have the longest and slowest walk to take the field. And when they get there, assuming that we're still holding strong, it will be a mass of humanity just south of Lark and Bell. We are not going to place any troops on Lark and Bell itself. My troops would take positions around in the wood line to make it appear that Lark and Bell is undefended. Ideally, the Confederate units will walk straight up the hill towards Lark and Bell and find themselves taking fire from both sides. Wood's brigade will be on the pivot point just to the left of Lark and Bell in the wooded area and racking up kills when the enemy tries to come up the hill. He will be backed up by an artillery battery. Initially, I have my two-star Napoleon battery centrally placed to cover most of the infantry in the center. I have a one-star battery of a dozen 6-pound field guns with a canister perk. I will move to the right side of Lark and Bell. When my reinforcements come in, I'll get another battery of a dozen 1-star field guns that I will place behind Woods to support him, and also a battery of 2-star ordnance rifles that I place right in the center of the screen, so they can cover the entire valley here. Stealing a wagon for this flank can be the difference between holding the line and being overrun. As I said, Bragg's forces come in from the lower left, moving on an angle towards the upper right. Well, once his forces are deployed, there are nearly none left on the left side of the screen. So if you're careful, you can sneak a cavalry unit down the left side and snag a supply wagon and possibly an artillery battery and get out before the Confederates come over to intercept you. The Confederates have a single, monster-sized cav unit in their area, so you need to be on the lookout for them because they will not hesitate to come after your cav. So when my cav come in with my reinforcements, I'll go try to get a wagon.
Thank you.
I'm not sure if you can notice how much slower the Confederate units charge up the hill around Larkin Bell as compared to when they were charging Shiloh Church on the right flank. It is slow enough to allow my units to get off more rounds and get them the route. One thing that can become an issue is that when the traffic jam gets started, they can have so many thousands of men south of Larkin Bell that it may trip the VP, even though none of their forces is as close to the VP as my own. I'm being a little more aggressive early on around Spain Field because I know that not all of the CSA units have deployed yet, so I'm trying to inflict as much damage as I can before the rest of them show up. My reinforcements are coming in, so I'll put a cav unit on each flank for now, get my other guns in place before Breckinridge's forces arrive, and move some skirmishers over to the right of Larkin Bell in the woods. There's a supply wagon and an artillery battery near General Bragg. I will try to see if I can take either one. I see Trabu as a duplicate, which helps decrease his overall size. General Breckinridge historically had the CSA reserve troops at Shiloh, so his brigades are hugely huge. Trabu, Statham, and Martin are his brigades. When you are operating behind enemy lines, always keep an eye on the mini-map in the lower right of the screen. Often, you may find that the enemy units pop up on the mini-map before you can physically see them on the battlefield. Probably shouldn't have charged the artillery because I'm not doing enough damage fast enough with these guys in the woods. I may take some damage before they break. But that wagon that we stole will let my guns fire at will until my own supply wagons show up later. One game mechanic that I've never understood is how a routing unit can drag a non-routing unit across the field into danger. In my opinion, the non-routing unit should be in control, or at least be able to detach itself quickly from melee, but as it is now, routing units can drag your cav all over the game.
Thank you.
See how Trabue's 1st Brigade thought he could walk right up and take the VP? But once Chalmers routed, Trabue starts taking fire from both flanks, including two smorgasbord batteries. If he turns to the left or to the right towards the enemy, then he'll end up taking rear flanking fire from the opposite side. That's exactly the effect that I want here. Statham is going to park himself in front of Loomis and Scales for about 30 minutes of game time soon and just tank everything that I throw at him. Even when he's supposedly routing the first time, he doesn't actually move very far. Having to shift fire to deal with Martin's brigade charging is going to allow Statham to recover his condition and start fighting again. Historically, Albert Sidney Johnston brought so much artillery that this was the largest artillery barrage on the North American continent up until that point in time. So while we're getting the CSA infantry under control, I need to start doing some raiding soon as this phase is over to cut down on the number of guns he has deployed here.
Thank you.
As the Hornet's Nest opens up, there are a few things I want to address. Number one is getting Steven's 3-star unit in my rear area to either surrender or shatter. Number two is getting my artillery reserves and my supply wagons up to Spain and Larkinbell Fields. Number three is covering or filling the gap between my two flanks until the Allied advanced brigades show up to handle that part. And lastly, to start collapsing the Confederates' left flank and pushing towards their right flank while raiding AI supply wagons and artillery batteries. This is definitely the best battle I've ever had at Shiloh. I lost slightly more than 17% of my forces. Again, I lost fewer troops than I captured. The AI lost nearly 80% of its forces. Obviously, tons of kills with Woods leading the score sheet. Some officers were evidently killed once, turned into zombies, and then come back to fight some more and get killed again. Or maybe not. I love it when captains jump up to lieutenant colonels in a single battle. I had over 7,000 SP-42s rescued in the previous Mobile Forces battle because Buell's troops arrived on day 2. But here, since I took a day 1 victory, I don't get weapons recovery from Buell's allied forces because they were never on the field. That wraps up the day 1 victory at Shiloh. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you at Seven Pines.